So I've been thinking about ChatGPT in particular, but generative models a little bit more generally. And obviously it's a hot topic. And as Dr. LeCun explained, it uses very simple methods to achieve amazing results. And the results are amazingly good, and they're also amazingly bad. And so what I'm trying to talk about today is give you a little bit of an overview of how amazingly good they are, and also a little bit of indication of what are the research problems that we have in order to make them better and to avoid some of the amazingly bad things that they do. So from a question and perhaps a set of instructions, these models are able to generate plausible, seemingly reasonable answers in many cases, and bad ones in others. And in fact, they now have enough memory that they can generate answers that are really part of a conversation rather than just a discrete answer to a discrete question. So that's pretty interesting. And the demonstrations, which I'm sure many of you have seen, show that they have excellent command of grammar, they can summarize long texts, they can extract information better than previous methods, they can follow instructions that say, you know, I want the answer in the following tabular format, and somehow it understands that and does it. You could ask it to explain the steps that it took to reach an answer, and it does some approximation to that. You can ask it to generate computer programs that will compute things, and often it gets the correct programs. And I'm not going to talk about this, but it also can generate images from textual descriptions. And so you read articles like this, ChatGPT performs at or near the passing threshold for the US medical licensing exam. That's pretty remarkable. I mean, these are hard tests that doctors typically spend, you know, several years studying to be able to do. Google then came out and said, oh, well, we have a better model that gets doctor-level performance on these medical exam questions, scoring 85%. The passing level is I think, 60%. So this is pretty impressive. Not to be outdone, the legal scholars then said, well, could these models pass the bar exam, national bar exam? And the answer is yes, and that it passed by a significant margin, earning a combined score that surpasses even the high threshold set by Arizona, which apparently is the toughest state to get a law degree in. Now, the question that I want to address briefly today is, why in the heck does this work? Because these models are trained on this ridiculously simple task that that Professor LeCun explained, which is essentially you take a huge corpus and, given any sequence of words, try to predict what the next word is. So this is not a new idea. If you start typing into Google, what's the weather, it'll give you a set of possibilities today, tomorrow, right now, in Boston, et cetera. Originally, these models were very simple n-gram models. They just counted the frequency with which certain patterns of word occurrence occurred in language. They then became more sophisticated. I think Google's is more sophisticated. And then in the last few years, we used these transformer architectures that are much more sophisticated and have many, many more parameters and are trainable to do a better job of essentially calculating the probability of any particular word or word fragment following some sequence of words. So The question that stuns me is, how does a system that's trained in this simple way exhibit the capabilities to pass a medical licensing exam or a bar exam, when really all it's doing is leveraging whatever it's learned from trying to predict the next word on a vast corpus? And the horrible thing is, I think nobody actually knows. So for instance, Sam Altman was interviewed by our Lex Fridman, and he says, do we understand everything about why the model does one thing or another? Certainly not. Somehow it's coming up with this reasoning capability. Well, that's not a very satisfactory explanation from the guy who runs the company that developed this technology. So it's hard for academics to figure this out, because despite their name, OpenAI is not so open about exactly what they do, what's the magic sauce. And I too welcome the fact that there's now an open source version of a similar language model that has just been released, which is wonderful. And the other problem is that it's difficult for university people to run experiments, because we don't have the computational capabilities of these very large systems that people have used in industry. So I'm going to tell you one result on a much smaller scale, and hopefully we can extrapolate that. By the way, there was an editorial or op-ed piece in yesterday's Globe by Daniela Roos, the head of CSAIL, who's talking about this problem of needing much more resources for academia to be able to do these sorts of studies. I feel sort of like, you know, in particle physics, if you wanted to reproduce an experiment that's being done at the LHC at CERN, step one says build another LHC. That's not a very practical solution. And so we either need to leverage the ability to run the models and fine-tune and build the models like industry does with their capabilities, because we're not going to be able to reproduce their capabilities easily. So, shockingly simple training and generation. Training task, predict the next word on a trillion tokens. Architecture, a transformer model with on the order of a trillion parameters. It's a huge model. And the training of the model learns an approximation to the probability of the next word in any sequence using this enormously complicated, sophisticated model. The generator works very similarly. It takes your question and some instructions, some of which are provided by ChatGPT in my example, some of which you, the user, can provide. It takes that as a string of text and says, what's the most likely next word after that? And that's the first word of the answer. It then appends that to what it had before and says, what's the most likely next word? Or maybe it's not the most likely one. There's some temperature that controls how much variation you get, so you may get a different answer the next time you ask. And you keep doing that, and that's all it does. Plus, there's this reinforcement learning to try to keep it from becoming a Nazi or to swear at you or doing various things like that. Now, contemporary machine learning modeling says that it's too expensive to have labeled data for all learning. And so we start with a bunch of unlabeled data, typically from the general domain. We pre-train it to do tasks like the next word prediction task. We then take unlabeled data from our target domain, do some more training. Then we take a little bit of training data from the domain we're actually interested in that's labeled, and we fine-tune using that data. And from that, we get a model that you can feed in data and get out predictions. Or in the case of language modeling, you feed in questions and you get out answers. So one question we asked in my group is, do we in fact still need clinical language models, or can we use general ones? And so we tried an experiment where we said, let's build a much smaller than the state of the art models just from clinical notes and see how well that does, or from a specialized model that's specialized with clinical notes, but starting with a model trained on general data, or just the general data fine-tuned on a little bit of our own data, or just using the general data and then trying to be clever in adding instructions on how it should answer our questions. And so we tested on three tasks: natural language inference, so can it make reasonable inferences, information extraction from radiology reports, trying to answer questions about follow-up instructions given to patients that are recorded in their discharge summaries. We looked at a bunch of different models ranging from, at that time, GPT-3, 3.5, which was the one in ChatGPT of its era. And we looked at a bunch of T5 models, which are smaller. And so we were able to compare these with our own experimental results. And what we found is that in natural language inference, the large clinical model does better than anything else, including the much larger model that's trained on just general data. So bigger is better, but in domain is better yet. And of course, the combination will do better overall. So I'm in the middle of writing an opinion piece for a subjournal of the New England Journal of Medicine, because I'm interested in medical areas, whose title is likely to be Generative AI Seems Miraculous, But Science Abhors Miracles. And so the question is, how could we possibly understand why these things are able to do the things that they are able to do? Now, Professor LeCun argues that they're not doing the right thing, that we have the wrong architecture. And so maybe that's the answer. But nevertheless, this wrong architecture does remarkably impressive things, and we don't know why. We don't understand how. So why do the models hallucinate? Because they're just doing probabilistic things, and some things are plausible, maybe not likely, but they get generated. ChatGPT, for example, is convinced that I died in 2018. Okay, as far as I know, not correct. And I think the critical question is, how do we move from training these models that are very good at language but don't know anything to models that actually have a representation of what they know and can therefore do symbolic reasoning with it in ways that are understandable to us? So my complaint is that most current research focuses on how can we exploit these wonderful capabilities and not on why do these capabilities exist in the first place. So here's the thing that's funny. A lot of the papers that I read treat these generative AI models as if they were natural phenomena. So if I'm trying to understand cosmology or biology or something like that, I don't have the design specs. And so the only way I can understand them is to do experiments and try to interpret the results of those experiments and figure out some theory of why things are the way they are. But this is an engineered artifact. We know we can read the code, especially if it's open source. So there's another method of analysis, which is engineering analysis, and yet that seems to be very difficult to do. I'm glad that Steve Wolfram is giving a talk later, because I've heard him argue in some oral presentations that maybe these models are just too complex to apply that kind of analysis to. So I'm looking forward to hearing his talk. Anyway, that's all I had to say today, and thank you for your attention.